since Michael returned. He was gone for more than 4 years, and now he has finally come back. The only thing is, he isn't the same anymore. I understand that. It's been 4 years. Of course he has changed. It's in the way he has changed that's odd. He barely ever smiles anymore. Only ever gives off the occasional hint of a smile, then it's quickly suppressed, and a blank, emotionless mask takes its place. Sometimes when we hang out, he would suddenly panic and start screaming and hitting himself in the chest and legs uncontrollably, and that usually goes on for a couple of minutes at the very least. Even though he still is my best friend, I'm afraid to be with him alone for what he might do. I'm not necessarily afraid that he would try to hurt me. It's that if he tries to hurt himself, I don't trust myself to be able to help him. Michael has been on TV many times since returning. Every news station and talk show were all over him for the first couple of weeks, offering a lot of money for him to be on their show before he appeared on any other. His parents were very against the idea of him being special investigators have been interrogating Michael a lot, and I mean a lot. According to rumor, they've been interrogating basically everybody, but they still don't have even a shred of evidence as to who the perpetrator could be. I've tried talking to Michael about it. It must have been incredibly traumatizing because every time I try to ease into the subject, he ends up freaking out and having a panic attack, or just getting oddly mad and leave. After a few attempts, I decided that it would be no good for me to ask him about it, and I would just wait until he was ready to tell me. And even though I desperately wanted to know what happened, it was okay if that never happened. I would leave that to his psychiatrist from now on. One other thing about Michael's behavioral changes since coming is that he sometimes acts abnormally when we do something that he enjoys. I took him to the skating park just last week, since skating is something that he used to love, and he kept repeating with even intervals, "I like skating, Thomas." Maybe you don't find that too strange, but the thing is, my name isn't Thomas, it's Isaac. I would correct him every time, and every time he would apologize and blame it on the scrambled since he got on the meds the psychiatrist was giving him. Those must be some strong meds, I thought. Even through all the odd behavior and lost memories, I still see my best friend. He is still in there, and I will be there for him every day, showing my support until he is fully healthy. One day, I decided it could do him some good to go out, drink, and just relax. Surprisingly, he agreed and asked me to pick him up at 9. When I got to his house, it was 10 to 9, and he was still getting ready, so I sat down in the kitchen with his mom as she was getting dinner ready. We talked about everything under the sun, and I eventually brought up Michael. Michael's odd behavior at the skating park. What kind of meds does that psychiatrist give him anyway? Don't get me wrong, Michael's been acting out of sorts even before those, but it seems even worse now. I mean, he called me Thomas repeatedly. Michael's mother, Martha, gave me a look that told me she had no idea what I was talking about. What are you talking about, Isaac? Michael hasn't had any medication prescribed. The doctors told us that would be more than like that would more than likely escalate his strange behavior, and it could also worsen his PTSD. By the mention of that last word, she lowered her gaze and looked incredibly sad for a split second. But when she looked up again, the sadness was gone, and she acted like nothing had happened. Then she went back to chopping vegetables for supper. I think it's good that you're taking him out to have some fun. You're a good friend, Isaac. Just remember to be careful. I promise we'll be as careful as we possibly can, I said with a hint of sarcasm, and Martha smiled genuinely. I didn't have any time to ponder what had just been said before Michael came jogging down the stairs. You ready? I asked him. Yeah, let's go. We said goodbye to Martha and got out to my car. That's when it hit me. Michael hasn't had any medication prescribed. That's what his mother said. Either he lied to me or he lied to her. But why? I had to know. Hey, Michael. What's up? You know, at the skate park where you told me you were on about that old Thomas thing because of the meds you were taking? Yeah. I mean, vaguely. So much for being careful, I thought. I don't feel like talking about it, he finally said. You look distant. Well, that was new and strange. What just happened? Alright, that's okay, man. No pressure. We soon arrived at the club, and the incident in the car was practically forgotten. Any troubles could wait until tomorrow, or even longer for that matter. Tonight was just about relaxing, taking off a load, and just having fun. We walked up to the bar to do some shots, first of all, and then see where things went. We decided on tequila. We downed a few shots and generally had a good time. Michael seemed to loosen up a bit when all of a sudden something felt wrong about him. He seemed way drunker than he should be. We had only done 3 shots so far. Michael was always quite the heavyweight when it came to drinking. When he spoke, he slurred badly. His pupils twitched to the sides and up and down. It freaked me out. It looked like he was having a breakdown, much worse than any of the panic attacks he had experienced before. I grabbed his shoulder and gently shook it. Michael! I had to scream to make myself audible. The club was deafening. What's happening? Are you alright? He didn't respond. His twitching got worse and worse until he fell from the bar stool down onto the floor, his whole body shaking violently, foam spurting from his mouth in waves. It seemed endless. Other people were now noticing what was happening. They helped me carry him outside, and someone called the ambulance. I was so shocked I just stood there, looking at him, feeling completely helpless. What if he died? They couldn't give me my best friend back just to take him away a month later. That couldn't happen. As the ambulance drove away, I stood still for a long time. Must have been like 30 minutes, just watching the road it had driven off on. They didn't let me come with them because they didn't want any distractions or interferences. At the same time as that had pissed me off, said them. I suddenly began sobbing uncontrollably and kicked a lone trash can into a wall as I screamed straight out into the night. An idea popped into my head as I stood there, devastated, and not a good one. Instead of going to the hospital to sit with my friend, or even informing his parents, which I was sure the hospital would do themselves anyway, I decided to head out to the forest where he had gone missing. myself in an attempt at mustering some courage, but I knew that was a lie. Something was here. Something had taken Michael. Something had broken him, and it felt like that something was watching me right this moment. Footsteps again, or no, not footsteps, dragging. Something was dragging against the ground close to me. That something was breathing heavily, wheezing in long, ragged breaths. I spun around, shining the flashlight all around me, but I could see nothing. Another sound could be heard right in front of me, a twig breaking. Something was coming towards me in the pitch black darkness, and it was moving slowly, very slowly. Isaac, a hoarse voice was calling my name. It sounded weak, dying. I slowly walked toward it, and what I saw made my heart stop in my chest. It was Michael, lying on the ground, a bloody mess. Apart from the wounds, he looked almost identical to when I had last seen him 4 years ago. I didn't even know what to think. My head was spinning. It's not real. You're not real. Since Michael was five. I now remember.